Good evening, everybody, and welcome to St James's Church, Piccadilly. This is one of the series of debates that St James's is holding in partnership with Just Share, which is a coalition of churches and charities committed to promoting a just share of the world's resources for all. They hold debates in the City of London, and we've just started holding debates over here in West London as well. We are tweeting throughout this event, and if you would like to tweet or follow us on Twitter, the hashtag is SlavesNextDoor. And the title of this debate, this discussion tonight, is indeed that, The Slaves Next Door, How Do We Fight Human Trafficking in London and Beyond? At St James's here, part of our history is that one of the leading abolitionists and freed slaves, Otobar Kuguano, was baptized here in August 1773 at the font just behind you on the left, at which the poet and prophet William Blake was also baptized. Otobar was baptized there, age 16, because he was told that baptism would prevent him from being carried away and sold again. We're here tonight to discuss human trafficking in London, but we will also be looking at that issue from a national and a global perspective. And we have some very notable speakers with us tonight, and we're extremely grateful to them for giving their time to us today. The format of the evening is that each of our speakers will speak, first of all, from this lectern about their own work and different aspects of human trafficking. We'll then have an opportunity for them to pick up on anything that the others have said back at the table there. And then we will have quite a long time for questions or things that you would like to say. So as the speakers are speaking, please do be thinking of what you would like to contribute to this discussion. There will be a lot of collective wisdom in this church tonight, and we hope that the discussion will stimulate your thoughts and questions and contributions as the evening goes along. Our first speaker tonight is Amy Jasper. Amy is the UK Community Network Coordinator for Stop the Traffic, which is a charity that seeks to empower and inspire activists from all over the world to help end human trafficking for good. Amy has worked with multiple NGOs on issues ranging from youth work and disability education to community engagement. She has experience working in Nepal, Cambodia, and Australia, and she's now working here in the UK with Stop the Traffic. Would you please welcome Amy Jasper?
Thank you, Lucy. It's great to be here tonight. So I'm going to sort of introduce you to the topic of human trafficking. It's a bit of a grim topic, so I thank you all for joining us this evening. A very serious issue that I think needs a lot more attention, and it'll be great to have a debate about in a little bit. So human trafficking is the fastest growing crime in the world, only just behind that of drugs. So it really is a very topical thing that we're here to talk about tonight. What often gets overlooked, though, about human trafficking, when we talk about human trafficking in the UK, is that it's something that happens right here in our own backyard. It's not something that happens in just far-flung places around the world. Most of the times when I go into training or training opportunities or events like tonight, we have these conversations around that it's happening in places like India, on tea plantations and in the cotton industry and garment making, or in West Africa on cocoa plantations. But What's really missing from the debate, I think, a lot of the time, is that it does happen here, and that vulnerable people are being preyed on right here in the UK. So we have these discussions about it doesn't happen here on my street in my communities. In this country last year, there was 2,340 people that were trafficked into or throughout the UK. They are only the ones that were referred into the National Referral Mechanism, which is the support mechanism for victims here, for survivors of human trafficking. So these are only the lucky few who've been identified, who were lucky enough to escape or to be found or to be identified in these situations. As we know, this is only the tip of the iceberg. The Met Police estimate that there could be over 20,000 people who are trafficked into the UK and throughout the UK every year. So human trafficking is a hugely profitable industry. There's a huge profit margin for people to make from buying and selling of people, and very low risk of being caught or being prosecuted for this crime. And what Stop the Traffic try to do is try to spread awareness and make sure that we can identify how do you spot the signs, how can we respond to people that we think might be trafficked, and how can we report it, because we need to bring those people to justice, otherwise they will re-traffic and re-exploit people. Unlike guns or drugs, that have a one-off or limited use, if you purchase a man, a woman, a child, you can use them day in, day out, for months, years, sometimes 5 to 10, 15 years. It's an ongoing appropriation of people's profit-making abilities, of their skills, of their lives, that we're talking about here in terms of, you know, the use of people and the exploitation of people. People can be exploited in a number of different ways. When we talk about exploitation and trafficking, we're talking about things like sexual exploitation, which I think is often the thing that comes to people's minds first and foremost. But there's also things like forced labour, street crime, domestic servitude, so happening in residential properties, benefit fraud as well. There's cases of children being purchased to seek housing benefits or claim benefits, forced marriage, and even the sale of organs, which is truly horrific. So when we talk about human trafficking, what we understand is that people are moved from one community into another community. So at Stop the Traffic, our work is very much community focused. How can we inform and empower communities to spot the signs and report things that they see? Traffickers prey on the hopes and dreams of vulnerable communities. So people are sold an idea of a better future, a dream of a better life for themselves or their families. So they're targeted and tricked by traffickers into lives of misery and exploitation. The UK is one of the largest destinations in Europe that people are trafficked to. And we know that there are people coming to the UK from Eastern Europe, from Africa, from Asia, and being exploited in a multitude of different ways. However, what we also know is that traffickers are preying on vulnerable British citizens as well. Homeless people, asylum seekers, are often being tricked and exploited. We've heard horrific stories of traffickers posing as homeless people in London and around soup kitchens and benefit centres and the like, and actually tricking them into, you know, offering them an opportunity for work or for a job, and then them disappearing and never being heard of again. In the UK, people are trafficked into working in nail bars, car washes, restaurants, on farms and construction sites, in people's homes, in terms of domestic slaves, and even as sex workers as well in residential brothels. And we've seen cases come to light as well, which I'm sure you would have seen in the media, in Rotherham and Oxford, where young people are being tricked and moved for the purpose of sexual exploitation. So as I said, we believe that communities are key to stopping the traffic. The key obstacle that Stop the Traffic sees in the UK around human trafficking is education. And that's why we go to events like this and why we want to tell people about what's happening here in London, but elsewhere around the UK as well. Communities need to know how it happens here and how to spot the signs. So we engage in frontline professional training, we deliver safeguarding to young people, and are campaigning globally as well to raise awareness of this crime. Stop the Traffic aim to build resilient communities that are hostile to human trafficking. This means that communities, exactly like I've been saying, are able to spot the signs and know how to report it and who to report it to. We all need to be equipped and empowered to know what trafficking is, how it affects us, and what we can do about it. So we need to be able to turn the tables on the traffickers to ensure that the risks of trafficking people are too high and the profits are too low, which I know some of my colleagues tonight are going to talk about in more detail. So we can do this by helping people spot the signs, report it, report to local authorities or the Salvation Army, and stopping and supporting survivors to bring criminals to justice. What we hope events like this do is highlight the extent to which human trafficking is taking place in the UK and what communities can do to prevent vulnerable people being tricked, exploited and trafficked internally and externally on a daily basis. So we know that traffickers are moving people across borders, across countries, but internally as well. So they have clever integrated networks, and we need to establish clever integrated networks to combat them as well, and make sure our networks against trafficking are connected across every town, every border. We all really do have a role to play in stopping this global crime. Thank you.
Our next speaker is the Reverend Marcus Walker. Marcus is the Associate Director of the Anglican Centre in Rome. Before being ordained, he worked for 4 years in Parliament on briefs including international development and the All-Party Parliamentary Group for Adoption and Fostering. He is at the Anglican Centre in Rome, which is effectively the Anglican Communion's embassy to the Vatican, and in that capacity, he represents the Archbishop of Canterbury in his new project, working with Pope Francis to fight modern slavery with the Global Freedom Network. And he's here to talk about that tonight. Would you welcome Marcus Walker?
Thank you very much indeed. Almost exactly two years ago, Archbishop Justin Welby visited Pope Francis for the first time. And just as their private meeting began, Pope Francis looked at Archbishop Justin and said, "Your Grace, you do realize I am senior to you." And Archbishop Justin looked, if I may say so, just a little disconcerted, perhaps a little affronted that there was quite such a stark, such a stark expression of papal superiority so early in their meeting. And then Pope Francis said, "By 2 days." The amazing work of the Holy Spirit in bringing together two men who are so similar at exactly the same time into positions of leadership in their communions cannot really be ignored. Where previously we had two scholar bishops who got on amazingly well together, now we have two worker bishops, two bishops who want to get out, two missional bishops who want to transform their churches. And in their first meeting, Pope Francis said to Archbishop Justin, "We must walk together as if we were already one." And over lunch, Justin Welby suggested that we as two churches, two communions, should walk together practically on an issue of social justice. And over that lunch, they decided that modern slavery should be the issue that we walk together on. And then they turned round to Archbishop David Motson, my boss, who's the director of the Anglican Centre, and basically said, "Your Anglicans in Rome, perfect, you make it happen," in the way that people often do. And so with very little more of a brief than that, at the first, Archbishop David got together with the Chancellor of the Pontifical Academy of Sciences and Social Sciences, who had already been tasked by the Pope with looking into this issue, and with an Australian billionaire, and decided that our churches should set up a body to fight modern slavery from a faith-based perspective, to draw together the great advantages that people of faith around the world have, to draw together the goodwill and the strength and the power that people of faith around the world have, and to use it, to harness that, to oppose modern slavery. This very quickly grew from being a bilateral Anglican Catholic body into being an interfaith body. Very early on, the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, the most senior scholar, the most senior cleric of Sunni Islam, said that he wanted to be involved as well, particularly because of the horrors that he has seen, and many of us, all of us, I hope, are aware of the resurrection of formal, legal, if one can put it that way, slavery in the parts of Iraq and Syria controlled by the Islamic State, soi-disant. And he wanted very firmly to be on record and involved in the fight against slavery generally because of that. This then grew to include not just Sunni Islam, but Shia Islam, with Grand Ayatollah al-Sistani, the most senior Shia cleric in Iraq, wanting to be involved. And it was decided that on December the 2nd we would have an event drawing together people of faith from around the world, leaders of the major faith communities from around the world, in a common declaration against trafficking and modern slavery. And it would be hosted in the Vatican. And with that common pledge would come an actual plan of action that these leaders could take back to their communities. And on the 2nd of December, Pope Francis and Archbishop Justin hosted if you have a little chance over there, there's a chance to head over there. We've got a booklet about the Global Freedom Network with a good, juicy colour photograph of all the leaders who attended this. We had the Patriarch of Constantinople, who spoke by video link. The Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Ayatollah al-Sistani, had to send, because of a direct threat to his life for attending this, had to send his number two and number three clerics, whom I had to get visas for with 4 days' notice, which isn't great when you're contacting the Italian Foreign Office saying, I need a visa for somebody whose title is Ayatollah and he lives in Tehran. And yet we did it. And now, the plan that all of these leaders have taken back to their communities, is one which is that we should fight slavery at its root. Its root is profitability. Slavery is now, as an industry, more profitable than oil. In fact, it was more profitable than oil before the collapse in oil prices. If we bankrupt slavery, we draw out the poison. We draw out the poison that makes people want to enslave others, that makes it worthwhile enslaving others. They've come up with 5 major areas in which we as people of faith can work to combating slavery and to making it unprofitable. The first is that major businesses, all businesses ideally, need to proof check their supply chains. Where do they get the things that make up whatever it is that they make? Most of us have a phone in our pocket, a smartphone of some shape or size. There is a solid chance that the gold, which is integral to the working of a smartphone, was mined by a slave. We, as consumers, can make it unacceptable for companies to use slave-sourced goods. And we, as electors, can make it essential that governments let us know if goods are slave-free, that companies let us know if goods are slave-free. This is nothing new. William Wilberforce did this 200 years ago. But if we can make it socially unacceptable to drink drive, we can make it socially unacceptable to use an iPhone that has slave mined gold in it, and we can make it socially unacceptable to eat a fish, a tropical fish, that's been fished by slaves in the East Indies. And we can make it socially unacceptable to use prostitutes who have been tricked, smuggled, enslaved, and drugged into a life of hell, whose life expectancy, if you are a sex slave, whose life expectancy is 7 years from capture to death. So the first thing is to proof the supply chains of major companies. Another link to that is proper law enforcement and reforms and legal reforms. Britain has passed the gold standard, really, of anti-slavery legislation. Theresa May, I know, actually made this a personal commitment, a really personal issue for her, and was helped by a cross-party commitment to fight slavery. But now to take this to other parts of the world and say this is what needs to happen, because in so many parts of the world, it is very easy to get away with having, owning, using and abusing your fellow human beings. Educating people, educating everyone in a country about the horrors, the existence of slavery. I would say if 3 years ago you'd have asked people about slavery, they'd think you were talking about the past. The issue's already started to come up on people's agendas, but it needs to come up much more. And it needs to be an issue which people care enough about that we will change our habits in order to respond to. We need to care for those who are victims and survivors of modern slavery, and realise that there are quite often strong incentives not to go to the police or to seek help if you are enslaved, if you think that you'll be deported straight away, if you think that by the time you go home, your family will know that you've spent 5 years in a brothel and won't want to touch you. We have to be alive to the reality of what happens to people who have been enslaved. And we need to mobilise our fellow Christians, our fellow believers in God, our fellow believers in other gods, to fight against this evil in their own countries or in our country, and harness the billions of people who think of this as an evil, and work in the countries where slavery is rife to end it there. And that's what the global faith leaders agreed on the 2nd of December. And that's what the Global Freedom Network, which was set up to harness these faiths, is working towards at the moment. And that's what the Anglican Centre in Rome is working to support. Thank you very much.
Next speaker is Steve Chalke, who began public life as a Baptist minister ordained in 1981, and you will know him as an author, speaker, TV and radio presenter, businessman and social entrepreneur. In 1985, he founded the Oasis Charitable Trust with a vision to build inclusive communities where everyone has hope, feels that they matter, and is given the opportunity to achieve their God-given potential. Steve is also the founder and chair of Stop the Traffic and is a UN Gift Special Advisor for Community Action Against Human Trafficking. Please welcome Steve Chalke.
Great, thank you everybody. Good evening to you. It's great for me to have the opportunity of speaking to you. Like Lucy said, back in 2005, I think it was, I began Stop the Traffic, which Amy's now a staff member of and works for. How do we stop the traffic? You've heard loads of great stuff already, and I'm sure we'll hear lots more. So I'd just like to say four short things. The first of them is this. We are the losing team. We're all on the losing team. I support Crystal Palace. Any Palace supporters here? Man United supporters here? There one? Chelsea supporters here? Do you not like football? You live near Crystal Palace. The thing is this. If after a match where one team has beaten another team 6-0, you sit the managers down, which manager do you want to listen to on how to play the game? We are the losing team. Everything we say comes from the losing side of this. As has already been said, the problem of the trafficking of human beings, the buying and selling of human beings, is growing. It used to be the third biggest crime in the world when I first worked for the United Nations. It's now the second biggest crime in the world. We are the losing team. So we need new tactics, new ways of thinking, new ways of exploring this. It's vital and it's now. The second thing I want to say is to back up what Marcus said just a moment ago. Really, no one ever gets out of bed to traffic people. When we talk about people traffickers, we make a big mistake. The truth is, people get out of bed to make money. And they get out of bed to make money morally. Most people who traffic people also traffic drugs and will traffic guns if they can and are involved in pornography. They get out of bed to make money. And they get out of bed to make money with the lowest risk and the highest return. The lowest risk and the highest return. So if we're on the losing side, which actually everybody in this game agrees on, I work alongside the UN, and it is well known that no one truly knows how much money traffickers make. And no one knows how many people are being trafficked through London. And no one knows how big this crime is, because we're on the losing side at the moment. But what we do know is this. No one gets out of bed to traffic people, they get out of bed to make money. And to pick up Marcus's point, therefore, it's simply a case of making the thing non-profitable. What we have to do, ladies and gentlemen, is raise the risks and reduce the rewards. The risks have got to go up and the rewards have to come down. But at the moment, as Amy pointed out so well, the rewards are huge from the buying and selling in and slavery of people. And the risks are very, very low indeed. That's what we've got to reverse. The third thing I want to say is this. It's a global crime. And because it's a global crime, the answers cannot be national. And they cannot be international. Globally, what we do know is that the trafficking circuit works in a joined up way. And you can't fight a joined up global crime just by working internationally or just by working nationally. One of the things I've learned through my work alongside the UN is this, not just in terms of trafficking, is that too often the world is run by people who think internationally. We use the term international and we use the term global as though they're interchangeable. Have you noticed that? You can pick up a newspaper, whether it's the Sun or the Financial Times, the term global and international get used as different ways of saying the same thing in the same paragraph without repeating a word. In actual fact, they're completely different ways of thinking. I've witnessed internationalism. A table is set, an American walks in, a Russian walks in, someone from China walks in, an Arab walks in, somebody from England walks in, and they all sit round the table to debate, let's say, poverty. But they're debating poverty and ending poverty and injustice, but I'm wearing a hat for the United Kingdom, and the guy from America is wearing a hat that says, And the US has got to be centre to this. And the man from China is wearing a different hat. There is no international answer to global problems. Only global answers to global problems. A globalist rather than an internationalist, I believe, and I've witnessed, is someone who sits round a table and says, it's our job to end injustice globally. And they take off the hat that tells you which country they were born in. And they're not interested in the economy working well in this part of the world at the expense of another part of the world. We need global answers to global problems, and this is a global problem. The last thing I want to say is just that it being a global problem does not mean that there are not local answers. Because in the end, a globalist approach is a joined up approach that makes sure that everywhere change happens. And of course, Marcus has just talked again about business. Business has a key part to play in ending trafficking. So does our political system, the laws we pass, the policies that derive from those laws. So does our legal system, so does our education system, so does our health system. And you go on and on. Our banking system. If all of this money is made by traffickers around the world, a great deal of it is banked here in London, which we pride ourselves is a global financial centre. How does all this money get laundered? Where does it go? That's why churches play a really important part. We play an important part, not simply because we can pray about these issues and highlight these issues, not simply because we can support some of the great charities and voluntary sector projects that are represented here in this room tonight and not represented here tonight, but because our churches are filled with people who bank, and they're filled with people who shop, and they're filled with people who serve in government locally and centrally. They're filled with people who run businesses and sit on boards. They're filled with people who work in shops. We are the people who either see the trafficking or don't. In the end, to stop the traffic, first of all, you've got to spot the traffic. So we all have a critical part to play. I close just with a story. The first time I went to the UN in New York. The UN has various bases around the world, and one of them is in Manhattan in New York. It's the famous one. And so I went there some years ago, before I worked with them, actually, to talk with them about the issue of trafficking. And I couldn't afford... I'm a Baptist minister. We're skint. And so I had to get the cheapest flight to the States, and I had to make it a day trip. So I got on this Virgin Airways flight that I got real cheap at the earliest one that flew, and I got to New York, and then there's a bus that gets you from JFK Airport. I've learned it's the cheapest way. It just costs a couple of dollars, basically. And you get on this bus, and it trundles through everywhere, but you get to Manhattan. And then you go, then I went off to see the UN, and then I came back out and I was queuing up outside a coffee shop, which is by Central, Grand Central Station, to get back on the bus, to get back to the airport, to get the last flight, to get home. And as I stood there in New York, which as you probably know is a peninsula, it was in the middle of the winter and the sky changed. It was a bright blue day, and then the sky went overcast, and it filled with that colour that is only there when it's about to snow. But New York is a hot and busy city, and you know the subways are running straight underneath the streets, cut and cover they call it, don't they? And there's all that steam coming out the vents, you know, a real New York scene, and the roadways are hot and they're busy, and sure enough, it started to snow. Giant snowflakes fell from the sky. It was wonderful. But I love this kind of thing. The snow's falling, and every time a snowflake hits the ground, it instantly melts. And you hold out your hand, and your hand is warm, and the snowflakes instantly melt. There's snow falling everywhere, and it's instantly melting. Anyway, I went into the coffee store to get a cup of coffee to warm me up. And when I came back out the store, an extraordinary thing had happened. These individual snowflakes, perhaps millions of them, had slowly overcome the heat, and the snow had begun to lay, and the streets had turned grey. And as I watched over the next quarter of an hour, I watched the streets turn white, and I watched those snowflakes stop the traffic. When one snowflake falls, it instantly melts. When millions of them fall together, they stop the traffic. We're on the losing team, but we can get joined up. We can make a difference, and we can, I believe, stop the traffic. Thank you.
Our last speaker tonight is Andrew Wallis. Andrew is founder and CEO of Unseen, which is an award-winning charity working towards a world without slavery. He's the chairman of the working group for the Centre for Social Justice's landmark report, It Happens Here, Equipping the United Kingdom to Fight Modern Slavery, which gave a comprehensive roadmap for government, statutory authorities and businesses to eradicate slavery in the UK, and is now acknowledged as the catalyst for the UK's Modern Slavery Act. He advises and collaborates with statutory agencies and businesses on how to combat and eradicate modern slavery. Prior to founding Unseen, Andrew had a career in business analysis, followed by commercial management in the retail sector, project management, and he led a church. He serves also on the board of a number of charities. Would you please welcome Andrew Wallis?
Good evening. The problem with going last is it's a bit like creeping death down the table and they nick all your best material. So I think what you've heard tonight is comprehensive, and let me see if I can just finish it off. I want to start with a working definition of what modern slavery is, because I think it's important that we understand what we're dealing with. And actually how we win. And I absolutely agree with everything that's been said so far. But let's see if this works. Modern slavery is an illicit trade in human beings turned into commodities to be bought, sold, and exploited for vast profits with little chance of discovery or disruption. That's what I mean, and what I think we're talking about tonight. What I've been asked to talk about is a little bit about the experiences that we have as Unseen in dealing directly with survivors, and then to somehow segue from survivors to business, but there is a segue, I assure you. So Unseen does three things primarily, and it's from a micro to macro scale. At the micro level, we work directly with survivors of human trafficking that have been found in the United Kingdom. In the middle, we equip stakeholders, be that statutory authorities, public agencies, businesses, corporations, and sometimes even government. And at the macro level, we influence government and society. And as Lucy pointed out in the introduction, I led the Centre for Social Justice's report into the issue of slavery in the United Kingdom. And it's quite something that when you look back at a report and both your key recommendations and your 80 general recommendations, to see the vast majority of them encompassed in the UK's Modern Slavery Act, which is the leading piece of legislation within the United Kingdom. There were five things that we called for. One was that there would be an act, but alongside that there would be a policy review of how the UK was responding to the issue. And both of those have come to fruition. We called for an independent anti-slavery commissioner, and that commissioner is formally appointed at the end of this month. We called for better care for victims. understanding that they had real needs, that caring for them better led to better prosecutions and better interaction with the authorities. We called for better care and recognition of children that were victims of trafficking and slavery. And fifthly, we called for transparency in supply chains legislation, which would force big companies to report annually what they were doing in order to ensure that not only the products, but the whole of their business was not tainted or complicit in modern slavery. So I'm hugely proud of what came out of that report. I'm honoured that Theresa May took up the challenge. So let me just talk a little bit about the perspective of working with survivors, because we can talk about the global issues, we can talk about the global faiths coming together, but ultimately when we talk about this issue of slavery and trafficking, we're talking about individual lives that have had a horrendous crime committed against them. And at Unseen, we have the privilege of dealing with that on a day-by-day basis. We operate 24/7 shelters, and we also have an outreach service. And we are what's called a tier one supplier within the UK's national referral mechanism, which means we take the most at-risk individuals. That's either at risk from their traffickers or at risk to themselves. And we provide a number of services to them whilst they are in with the national referral mechanism. We've seen 25 nationalities in the last 12 months. We've seen people with master's degrees in business and accountancy at one end of the spectrum, and at the other end of the spectrum we see people who are so severely traumatized by the experiences that they've gone through that they disassociate and they go into a coma-like state, and we have to call 999, sometimes four times a day for one individual. We've seen people suffer, and we can, you know, when you're in this field, you can just trip these things off the tongue, but we see people that have suffered from sexual exploitation, forced labor, domestic servitude, forced criminality. But that could be you, could be your son, your daughter, a family member that has had horrendous human rights violations against them. No one case is ever the same, but we now have a hugely highly trained team that operate around the clock, that deal with the issues of trauma, that deal with the issues of am I going to be able to stay in this country, that deal with the complex legal issues that face these individuals, that deal with issues around, well, where am I going to be housed when I leave this safe house, that deal with issues that I'm an EU citizen, and because I can't prove for the last 3 months that I was being forced to work as a prostitute and I don't have a P45, I am no longer entitled to benefits or housing and I'm at the bottom of the pile. We deal with the crap of life. So out of that, we decided to start a reintegration service, really out of a commitment long-term to these individuals. And for us, what long-term commitment means is that we need to work with people back to a place of resilience and contributing to society. We talk about victims. The moment they walk into one of our services, we refer to them as survivors, and the moment they walk out of the service, we refer to them by their name. Because they don't really want to walk around with the title of I'm a survivor of trafficking, or I'm a victim of trafficking. They just want to be known as John or Flossie. They want to get on with their lives. So some of the problems that they face, and this is just a snapshot, and I could have done 10 minutes on the problems that they face. I could have done 10 hours on the problems that they face. But they face problems like the police choosing not to investigate their crime any further. It's just not important. We take them through the process of why a conclusive grounds decision is negative when all the evidence is pointing to the fact that they clearly were exploited and trafficked and were a victim of modern slavery. We deal with their health needs. That's everything from emergency dental care because their front teeth have been smashed out with a hammer as a means to control them, to STDs and STIs, to horrendous physical problems, to the emotional problems, to the mental needs, to night terrors, to being too afraid to go to sleep. One of the things that we do the moment they walk into our shelter is we give them a key to their room. We tell them, we will never come into your room unless you invite us in. You, from this point on, have control back in a little way over your life. We deal with the trauma and the outworkings of trauma. We deal with what's next, and that's dependent on their nationality, on whether the crime's been investigated, and whether they're willing to engage with the crime. Do you know, this is the only crime in which you have to sign something formally in order to access services. We don't require it for someone that's a victim of domestic abuse or a burglary. I've been burgled. I didn't have to sign something that then said I was entitled to what I'm entitled. But with victims of trafficking, we just make it a little bit harder. We deal with issues of housing, whether they're entitled to benefits, whether they're entitled to stay in the country, what it means if they go into the asylum process. This is the reality. These are the consequences of modern slavery. So how does this, how on earth do you segue from that into business? You don't, you just jump. The Modern Slavery Act contains a clause within it. This is the bit that I'm most pleased about. And we led a charge on this issue, and we brought together NGOs, faith communities, investors with over £1 trillion of assets under management in the United Kingdom, corporates, industry leaders, including Richard Branson, and said to the government, you have to include this piece of legislation. This is the only systemic piece of the legislation. The rest of the bill is about policing and the care of victims and about the UK. This bit, Steve, is global. You'll like this bit. Transparency and supply chains legislation. Its reach is global immediately, because what it says is that all companies over a certain size, which is yet to be determined, but probably going to be about 36 million, which means about 17,700 companies, will have to annually disclose what they're doing to ensure that modern slavery does not exist in their businesses. That report will have to be signed off by the board, which creates immediate fiduciary duty. And they have to report iteratively year on year. So I'm really excited to think, well, what does this look like in 10 years' time? Because in year one, I think we'll have a lot of companies going, I have no idea what this issue is, I'm going to have to start investigating it. But in 10 years' time, hopefully we will have created a race to the top, where companies will be outdoing each other in order to prove that the goods and the services that you purchase and that I purchase are free from slavery. They'll have to talk, hopefully, about things like their company structure, their supply chains. They will have to do what most corporations have failed to do, which is begin to map their supply chains all the way to source. It's doable. Most corporations will tell you, oh, I can't do it, to which my response is, well, why does a Guardian journalist only need 2 weeks to map the whole of your supply chain? It's not that difficult, clearly. They will have to talk about how they train their staff, what contracts they issue, what they will do around procurement policies. I have a background in retail management. Let me just tell you a little bit about procurement. Procurement, you're entirely incentivized on the level of profit that you can make. So you really don't care who's making it or where it's been made or the conditions under which it's been made, as long as it's cheap, because if it's cheap, it increases your profits. What your HR policies will be. What your policies and procedures will be if you do come across slavery. These are just some of the things that companies will over time begin to tell you and I. What this piece of legislation has done is it has leveled the playing field. For those businesses that are good and that are already doing this and committed to doing this, it's an encouragement to do more. For those that want to do more, it's the permission giving. And for those that have been cutting corners, it begins to stop them in that whole process. Why is it important? Because fundamentally, modern slavery is an issue of economics with horrendous human rights consequences. It's a supply and demand illicit trade. The ILO, part of the United Nations, always a conservative beast at the best of time, estimates that the profits annually from modern slavery are $150 billion per annum. That dwarfs every major corporation in the world. In fact, you could lump Apple, Microsoft, BP, ExxonMobil, most of the airlines, and you still wouldn't come close on profitability. Why does transparency in supply chains matter? Why do businesses care? Enlightened businesses care because they know that doing the right thing is ultimately better for them as a business. It's better for them in terms of profitability, it's better for them in terms of worker engagement, and it's better for them in terms of sustainability. Government, the UK government, has done its bit by passing this legislation. Business now needs to respond. Not because of the legislation, but primarily because it makes economic sense. Because just stop and think about it. $150 billion of profit. That's of interest to government because there's no tax take. And it's of interest to business because it's money that's not in the legitimate economy, but in the illicit economy. So what can we do with this challenge? Well, when these reports start coming out, probably in April 16, read them. Then ask questions respectfully. Don't bully companies, just ask the questions. What do you mean by this? What more can you tell us? And then before you feel too smug, realize that we're all complicit. Marcus already alluded to it. We all have smartphones in our pockets. You're all probably wearing an item of cotton clothing, and you've probably eaten prawns or organic salads in the last 10 days, which means you probably have in the globe 40 to 60 slaves working for you already. But shall I get up close and really personal? Have you had your car washed by one of those hand car washes? It's a fiver and the car looks great. And maybe, ladies, you've had your nails done at one of those nail bars where they don't speak English. There's always someone in the corner watching, and there's probably a CCTV camera. And the nails are really cheap, but they look great for the weekend, don't they? Your cars, your manicure, was probably by a slave. So use your resources wisely. Become political with a small p, but be informed. A lot of you work for businesses that will be caught by this legislation. Make sure your company is leading the race to the top.
Thank you very much. Well, we've got some time for questions in just a moment, so please do be thinking about a question or a comment that you'd like to make. But just before we go to the audience, one thing that struck me from what you've all been saying is that it may be that those of us coming to an event like this might be driven by a sense of compassion and confusion about what to do about a situation that we know is tragic for the individuals involved and much more prevalent than we might think. But one of the things that all of you have been emphasizing is not compassion, but appealing to the profit motive. You've been very hard-nosed about it. Steve, you said you're on the losing side. You've been talking about the smartphone. Amy, you were talking about the prevalence of human trafficking. Do you think that, I mean, what's the mixture of motive? Do you think motives matter in this fight against human trafficking and the eradication of slavery? Anyone like to?
Yeah, talk about that, Amy? Well, Andrew summed it up nicely, didn't he? It's about economics,
right?
First and foremost, it's the buying and selling of people for profit. There's no two ways about it.
So the way to combat it is economically and politically.
Exactly. Yeah, hit them in their pockets where it hurts. Yeah.
Steve.
What I'd say about it is this. I think that we can learn some lessons from the past. We all celebrate William Wilberforce and the ending of the transatlantic slave trade. You know that bill, I'm sure you'll know the story because we celebrated his anniversary just a few years ago. It went to Parliament time after time after time after time, and it was defeated time after time after time after time. And eventually it was passed, and we all celebrate that, and we remember that, and we teach about William Wilberforce's great achievement in our schools, etc. There's another way of looking at it. And the other way of looking at it is this. Wilberforce and his friends, the Clapham sect, through their campaign that lasted across two decades, eventually they produced a book. And the book was on the economics of slave trading. It's got a very long title, but it was about the economics of slave trading. And Wilberforce and friends basically realised that there was no point appealing to people's sense of charity. What you needed to appeal to was the pound in their pocket, and teach them that there was a better way of doing business, a more joined up and more healthy way of doing business. And I think that that's a tactic that we should be adopting.
I think that what Andrew was talking about is great, about the supply chain thing in the what is now the Modern Slavery Act, but it's weaker than it should be, as I'm sure Andrew would say, much weaker than it should be. And there's a real fight that went on with lots of people involved to get what is there in there. So I think that the battle's not over. It's not done. What we've got to do is keep on this so that businesses become convinced that the best way of doing profit and the best way of keeping customers is to do ethical business. I think that the economic thing is at the heart of it all.
Andrew.
So I'm a bit like the poacher turned the gamekeeper, or is it the other? I never know which way around it is. So I used to work in business. So let's just talk about our addiction to cheap, because that's actually the heart of it, and that's what drives and creates the environment in which trafficking and slavery can exist. So ultimately it becomes an uncomfortable truth for all of us. And so actually the bigger debate is around capitalism 2.0, because if we carry on the way that we are, we will not eradicate slavery, because it's about systems process. And systems process is the systems are designed to perfectly deliver the results that you're getting. And if you're not happy with the fact that you live in a world where slavery has come roaring back, then you have to go back to say, well, what is the process that allows this to flourish? And it comes down to supply and demand. Slavery only exists because there is a desire and a demand that the slave masters and the traffickers are feeding. And it's the demand for cheap goods and cheap services and cheap labor and cheap sex and cheap money. And that's how they exist. They think and operate like business people. But that doesn't get us off the hook. It's not their fault. They're just meeting the demand that we've created. So actually, there's a much, much bigger debate that needs to take place if we're going to tackle this. And that's a debate that freaks government out, and it's a debate that freaks business out. But there are some businesses that are beginning to lead on that. So if you look at some of those businesses that are around the B Corporation, and what they're beginning to talk about is saying, we cannot carry on as we are. We will ruin the earth beyond the point of no return, and we will not address these issues of modern slavery around the globe. And that's where we need to focus things.
And are you saying that then the appeal to the profit motive is a penultimate solution? It can only ever be a penultimate solution, because within the system that we're operating, that's the way to get people to reduce trafficking, but that ultimately that motive isn't sustainable.
All right, I'm going to go right off the cliff now. So if you go to the States, business there is on this treadmill of reporting every quarter, and it reports on its profitability and to its shareholders and everything else, and that just drives the quick return and the quick buck and everything else. And that leads to all the corners being cut, because actually the shareholder is king, and you've got to give back on your investors, and you've got to have as big a profit margin as you can. But there are consequences. There are consequences to that model. And so actually we probably need to get used to the fact that actually, you know, at our level, do you need those 20 t-shirts from Primark? I'm not picking on Primark, but do you need those 20 t-shirts from Primark in order to have an enjoyable summer holiday? I mean, like, how many t-shirts can you wear? I mean, I always take 5 and only end up wearing 1 and come back smelly, but do you see what I'm saying? It's all an interconnected system. And so actually, as a society, we've got to have a rethink around that, and we've got to have a rethink around what is an acceptable profit level that we're asking businesses to make.
If I'm right, both of you are still talking about using the operation of the market, i.e. consumer power, or appealing to businesses, not just looking at the bottom line. You're both arguing that that's the way to combat slavery, because traffickers think like businessmen, Steve.
Yeah, well, traffickers are businessmen. I mean, and women, actually. It's not just men that run this thing.
Yeah.
And they're in it, as we've all said, for money. I'd just like to stick up for Primark just slightly for a minute. I know Andrew wasn't. Andrew wasn't picking on Primark at all, but it's ever so easy for you to wander away with the wrong idea of what Andrew was saying. The thing is, you can buy a T-shirt for £5 in Primark, or you can go into some wonderful Mayfair store here and buy a T-shirt for £100, and the T-shirt for £100 might just as well have been the result of traffic labour as the cheap one. Trafficking in the cotton industry, Amy's an expert on this, I think, is a real problem. It's a very real problem. And it's to Andrew's point, as cotton is produced, it goes through so many processes between being harvested and eventually ending up in a warehouse and then being designed and then turned into a T-shirt, that actually there's no difference very often between the cheap one and the expensive one. What we need is one that's fairly traded. And that's a different thing.
Amy, would you like to say something about clothing? Is that something that you could...
Yeah, well, I guess this is something that we're campaigning on quite heavily at the moment, is especially given it's summer, and exactly like Andrew said, people are going on summer holidays and thinking about what are the latest trends, or what are the things that they need to be seen to be wearing on Facebook or on Instagram or whatever it might be. But how do we... inform and make sure that we make the right choices that aren't having an impact elsewhere. I think the other thing that's is at the other end of our desire for cheap goods is that it's also pushing people into more and more extreme cases of poverty and getting into these situations where they can be exploited. So you've got to think of the other end of the spectrum as well. It's not just about the T-shirts that we buy and the impact that you have on here and whether it's the latest colour of the season, but it actually has a much greater impact on, in Tamil Nadu, where they're producing a lot of the cotton that are on, end up in our high street chains, comes from, and how the women there are, it's a whole scheme and chain that happens in these communities that is totally exploitative. And that has become commonplace because of our desire for cheap goods.
Yeah.
Thank you. There's a leaflet on this, isn't there?
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes. You can sign our postcards and take them to your local high street shops and ask them where their clothes are made.
And now's the time to tell you, after we've finished here, there is a glass of wine or a soft drink over there where you can pick up leaflets with all of these organisations and get ourselves educated with that. Fairly traded wine, yes. Marcus?
Could I answer your question very directly, I think, which is, should we be focusing on the profit motive, or should we actually be engaging with people's consciences? Yes. Should we be engaging with the morality of the question
as well? Yes. Yeah.
I would say, first of all, it should actually be both.
Right.
If you consider in 1861, when the southern states in America rebelled, they were convinced that the British Empire would support them because the British cotton industry was dependent upon the cotton trade of the South. And to their shock, the predominantly northern textile workers supported the North wholeheartedly, and it became politically unconscionable for the government to support the southern states. There's a huge need to engage people's consciences on this question. And it's by engaging people's consciences that around the world, people will start engaging in the activities that will bankrupt slavery. Because the other side of it, I think, is that we have to engage in the real world, which is, whilst people are making money or can make money out of something, they will find ways of doing it.
Yes. As would most of us. I mean, it's kind of accepting our own complicity as well, and understanding that that's in itself a motivation to change our own behaviour as well.
Yeah. Yes.
Can I take some questions from the floor then, or some comments? We've got some roving microphones, so perhaps over this side, Simon. Perhaps we could. I'll take one or two together. This gentleman at the back there. Yes. Yep. If I could ask you to be brief and perhaps stand up, that'd be great, and speak very closely into the microphone.
Hello. Good evening, Gary Hayes. It's really based on sand. We have overpopulation, so there's really no choice about how we treat people. If you buy your kitty cat inside that tin, there is a very badly treated cow, which is a factory farm, basically. If we have these approaches to other species, we're going to continue abusing ourselves.
Thank you very much. I'll take another comment. Yes, this gentleman there? Yep.
I wanted to kind of come back a little bit about the kind of point. I mean, I think the point's been made that it needs to be a response of compassion and economics. I suppose I'm a mental health nurse by background, a university lecturer now training mental health nurses, and I spend a large proportion of my time in the classroom politicising my students. It's my view you can't be a good mental health nurse and not have an opinion about this kind of issue. For me, I'm a mental health nurse because I saw Steve walking through a slum in India some 25 years ago on a video up in North Wales at an event that he was talking about the need for medical and nursing staff, and that was the direction in which my career is headed. And in turn, I'm then impacting a generation of nursing students having worked for 10 years in the NHS. But it's that sense of, for me, being driven by compassion there's then need to drive that sense of practical engagement with sort of all spheres of expertise and life. My PhD is based in Thailand and is exploring the impact of sex trafficking in Thailand in regards to mental health. Mm. And so it's about making connections, I think, for me, between things like economics and the whole kind of social sphere, and building that in. And to my mind, there's just a basic principle about doing the right thing. And yeah. Whatever our expertise, whatever our area of life, there is something whereby this kind of connects. Mm.
Thank you very much. And we'll just take this last person at the front here. Yeah. Then I'll ask you to comment on anything you've heard.
Thanks. I just want to say that one of the speakers, I think it was Steve, said something about decreasing the reward and increasing the risk. Okay. So I lived in Tamil Nadu for 3 years, working for an organization there, fighting slavery, and we rescued about 3,500 people over the course of 3 years. And in the facilities that we were rescuing people from, in almost every case, actually, it should have been very, very easily spottable by police, by local authorities, by others. So I'm interested not only in the reduction of profit side of this, but also the increasing of risk side of this. So I'm a great believer in the building actually of law enforcement as well to protect vulnerable people. So I don't disagree with what any of the panelists are saying in terms of sort of the economic solution, but at the same time, we've really got to focus on the building of law enforcement as well to increase the risk for people who are doing this.
Would anyone like to comment specifically on that last one about increasing risk? Perhaps Marcus and then Andrew, yes.
Last Sunday, living in Rome, it was very hot and I decided I would head to the beach. And on my way to...
Wearing a Primark t-shirt.
Way to go.
I'm so good.
Yeah, go on, carry on.
Discovered a long time ago that t-shirts do not fit my physique. But but on my way along the beaches, or to get to the beaches, every 10 yards or so, there was a lady, generally black, sitting on a plastic chair, and immediately behind her was a mirror. And this is well known in Italy. This is a prostitute's run. And basically, these women, who are almost all sex slaves, or will almost certainly be sex slaves, are dropped off one after the other in the morning, given their mirror so that they can fix themselves up afterwards, and then they will sit there all day waiting for a client to come along. And this is in broad daylight. The police will drive past however many times. But the police might at best have no interest in dealing with it, and at worst are actively complicit, are actively being paid off in order not to engage with it. Of course, in Italy, you've got the added problem of almost, they're hitting the point of systemic collapse in terms of being able to handle the migration crisis that's hit them. But there's also a total lack of interest in engaging with it.
Thank you. Andrew, you mentioned police choosing not to investigate crime, etc. What would you like to say about law enforcement increasing risk?
Gosh, how long have we got? I think in the last 3 years, let me just talk about the UK, then I'll go global very quickly. In the last 3 years, because the Act has come in, that is a strong push from the politicians onto law enforcement in this country to say, actually, this is a priority. The issue of slavery and trafficking is now deemed that it is a national strategic threat to the United Kingdom, which means the National Crime Agency have to report on it month by month to the Home Secretary. And it is a priority at regional organised crime unit level, and it is slowly coming onto the strategic assessments of every single police force. And we have an ACPO lead on that issue. So that helps. But it needs to get down to the bobby on the beat, who can recognise it, identify it, know what to do when they find it. The truth is 95 to 99% of all victims of trafficking are found by either law enforcement or border agencies in this country. So they need to be better equipped to identify it. Globally, you're absolutely right. What's absolutely vital is the rule of law and order. And where we see good rule taking place, then actually we see better identification of victims in that whole process. But the flip side of that is actually, how does someone end up in a situation of modern slavery? And that is, they've become vulnerable. And traffickers play on that vulnerability, whether that's in the initial deception, or whether that's because of poverty, or increasingly it will be around climate change, or war, or persecution. Once someone becomes vulnerable, the traffickers swoop in really, really quickly. We see this in Syria and Iraq. We see this in sub-Saharan Africa. We see it around the globe, that where people become vulnerable, they become vulnerable to the traffickers. And it is it's astonishing when you get below the surface of just the level of sophistication that these people operate with, down to a point of, in this country, you want which nationality, what age, what size, we can have it for you within 24 hours, which is why we've commodified human beings.
Thank you. Can I take some more over this side? Yes. Just at the front here. So this lady here.
The question is really, you've been talking about the fact that we need to get rid of the addiction to cheap, as you mentioned, as you said. The problem is, so many people in this country have not enough money to buy something that is of a better quality, or that is made in a better way, or without trafficking. How can we deal with that? Because they, in a way, are also in a situation that's almost equal to trafficking.
Thank you. We'll pick that up. I'll take the gentleman behind. Robert? Yeah.
It just interests me how the sort of practicalities of this work in Britain. If I'm an unscrupulous businessman and I decide I need cheap labour, I just go down to some scruffy pub in the East End or something. There I will meet people and I say to them, I want a dozen workers and I don't expect to pay them. Can you supply them? He'd say, yes, certainly, but it will cost you such and such a figure. Is that sort of thing actually go on?
Thank you. Thanks, Mike. And this lady here. And yeah.
Good evening.
Good
evening. Thank you very much for your presentation. It was very insightful. I'm Zhongli. I'm from Shanghai, and I find it very. I do appreciate the fact that you attach great importance on the education, like your former prime minister said, education, education, education. It is very important because I didn't know that we can have economic approach to treat this problem that is so serious, so sentimental. Actually, it's just a problem of risks and profit. Thank you very much. And the next time when I play with my smartphone, I might think about my compatriots fabricating this smartphone in some very dingy factories. Well, I have a very concrete question. I've heard of the Global Slavery Index. I'm not quite sure I understand this concept. I don't know if you use this concept in your daily work or not, and how do you use it? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Who'd like to speak about the Global Slavery Index? Do you know about it?
Yeah.
The Global Slavery Index is trying to quantify how many slaves are around the world. I think we all said it at some point. The honest answer is we don't know. The UK government talks about dark data, which is code for we haven't got the foggiest. We know it's a big problem. The Home Office revised its figures up at the end of last year from, you know, probably 3,000 to 10,000 to 13,000, and you could probably put a multiplier on that. Globally, estimates are between 21 million, which is the ILO's figure, and the Global Slavery Index is 36 million. But when you peel it away, it's based on really, really flimsy amounts of evidence, and so it's an extrapolation. All I know, you know, at the grassroots level, is every single bed that we have in all of our shelters, the moment one becomes free, it gets filled again. It's just constant. So, take your number.
Could I ask somebody to address the issue that the lady raised there about affordability? That it's all, you know, the addiction to cheap was your phrase, Andrew, but Steve and Marcus, you both spoke about
that. Affordability. I think this is where it comes back to character traits or virtues rather than just economics. Mm. Our fight is a fight for justice. I am a Christian. I'm a follower of Christ. Over the years, it's his call that's motivated me. I think in many of our churches, following Christ is sold as forgiveness. I've been forgiven. I think forgiveness from God is an extraordinary thing that is beyond our comprehension. But I think the gospel is about more than forgiveness. I think it's about partnership. I think that every time I pray the Lord's Prayer, Jesus tells me to pray, Our Father who is in heaven, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, right here, right now, where you live. I believe that we're all called to that. So we live in one of the most affluent cities in the world, and yet there is huge poverty here. There are many people who not only can't eat, they can't be here. They can't rent houses or flats. They live in damp flats, in bad conditions. They're constantly ripped off by landlords who don't care. But I think there's a way of matching all of this up with our behaviours as well, because in any church, you'll find people who've bought a flat as an investment and are told by the agent, you can get this much rent. And it's really good, because that rent can go to our pension or whatever it is. So we can find ourselves too easily on both ends of this. Mm. Appealing for justice, yet supporting a system that benefits us, as Andrew said, that oppresses others. Mm. Yet we've got to be committed to all of these issues, and I believe that we're held responsible by God for that real commitment.
Yeah. Oh, I just want to add to what Steve was saying, and I think I mentioned in my... Oh, sorry. I just want to add to what Steve was saying, because if we look at the National Referral Mechanism statistics, UK citizens are in the top five. So there are vulnerable people. That's what I mean. It's not just, we talk about this, it is a global issue, but there are people here who are, exactly as you said, in vulnerable situations that are also being targeted and preyed upon. And I think that is part of the issue that we also need to address. Yes, it's a global issue. Yes, people are being exploited in the supply chains that things are being produced elsewhere, but it's also back back at home as well.
I'm going to take some more from the audience. This is our last kind of round, so I'll try very hard. Gentleman here at the front with the blue t-shirt.
Dominic Pinto. I'm not a fellow traveller or fellow believer as such, but I think it was actually as much conscience as anything else which took me into the fair trade movement a very long time ago when I was at Newcastle University, and since then I've worked in fair trade. So fair trade, or fairly trading, is clearly part of a solution that's part of, if you like, a market approach to solution. Unfortunately, the shirt probably isn't fairly traded, but there's plenty of options around. I think even Primark have fairly traded cotton.
Thank you.
But more importantly to me, we talk about slavery as being the second fastest growing after drugs. One of the solutions put forward for drugs is decriminalisation, but that clearly politically will never, well, unlikely ever to happen. To legitimise the drug trade is to actually take, if you like, illegality out of it. That is not a solution for slavery. So I'm wondering if there's anything quite as simple and straightforward as decriminalising the drug trade would be part of the solution. And I haven't really heard anything so far other than maybe attacking the bankers and the banks, because that's at the heart of it, is the financial transaction mechanism.
Okay. Thank you. And I want to take this lady here at the front.
Hi, thank you. So I know that the UK has a 45-day reflection period for any of the survivors discovered. What I'm curious about, though, is, I mean, especially you with the unseen, you deal with the survivors all the time. These survivors, they have two options as far as I can tell. They either go asylum or they can cooperate with the police and get residency, which is extremely difficult for them sometimes. Now, if they go the asylum route, as far as I know, the asylum laws in the UK don't allow them to have jobs, to have employment. So what do they do? I mean, if they're sent, sometimes I know a lot of them are sent back to their home countries, but that just kind of sticks them back in the situation that they were trying to escape from in the first place. So what can the UK do to make residency easier for these people? Because that's the only way that they can actually get jobs here.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to take one more and just really be very brief, please. This guy just there, yeah.
Hi, I have quite a specific question in that. I feel as a Christian and as a human being, I feel called to the nations and particularly to some parts of Asia to combat some of this stuff. And as a 27-year-old guy with no kind of qualifications, BA or anything like that, in international development or humanities, all this kind of stuff, my question is, how do people like me who want to kind of be on the front line, as it were, get into those areas of work?
Thank you. I'm going to keep that question, because at the end I'm going to ask the panelists all to give us something that they think we can do, so I'll ask them to pick that up. We've got time for one more then, so this gentleman here over on the right. Yep.
Hi, my name is Wynne Lewis. I'm a parish vicar in the United States, and thank you for helping me to be mindful of my role in facilitating the conversation and education. I just have one question, and that is, can you point to a global corporation? You mentioned Richard Branson, but a particular global corporation that has moved to identify the supply chain and to be perhaps to lead the pack in becoming conscious of how human trafficking affects their organization. Thank you.
Okay, very quickly, we're going to run through this. So we had a question about education, the importance of raising awareness. Would somebody like to say something about that as part of a suite of responses, I suppose? We talked about economics, we talked about the faith response, the education. How can that happen when most people don't think there are any slaves in the UK?
Yeah, I think that's really easy. It's It's getting the word out there. It's once you've come to an event like this, go home, talk to your friends and your family. It starts there. It's really that easy. And then we need to get out and we need to be talking to the mental health workers. We need to be talking to, you know, the people who are travelling and interested in getting into international development about how it's happening in their country, but in other countries. It really is about starting the conversation, and that's what this evening is doing. You know, starting to talk about that it is an issue that does happen here and elsewhere around the world, and how we are a part of that as well.
Is there a global example? Richard Branson was mentioned. Anything?
Yep. Yes, Andrew Forrest, who was the billionaire who helped set up the Global Freedom Network with us, came to this cause because his daughter, when on her gap year, realised that people she was with were in fact, or some of the people in the village she was with in Nepal were in fact slaves. And this shocked her to such an extent she went back and shocked her father, who then embarked on a process of decontaminating his company. And he set up the Walk Free Foundation, which is a major anti-slavery body, and which in fact produces the Global Slavery Index. And on their website, he explained exactly how he did go through and supply, check the supply chains of his business. And he's working with the Archbishop of Canterbury, who's planning this year or early next year to host a conference for major corporations in London to tell them how they can do it, how they actually effectively can do this.
Okay, that's a good example. We're coming to a close now, so I'm going to ask all of our speakers to talk to us about something that we can do, so a response either collectively or individually. I'm going to go in the same order that we spoke, so Amy first. Okay. How can we respond as people to this?
Yeah, so this is Stop the Traffic sort of core business, as it were. You know, we engage in communities. We have volunteer groups all around the country who are helping us train frontline professionals, train in schools, in churches, in business groups. We have our campaigns. We have local campaigns looking at targeting taxi drivers, how they might be used in their vehicles in terms of moving people around for exploitation, hotels, GPs, looking at how we can talk to postal workers and these types of people who are on the streets every day in communities. And then the other one is the supply chain piece, which I'm sure my other colleagues are going to talk about. Grab a postcard, take it into your local high street fashion store and ask them, where are they sourcing their cotton from? We are having great response. Companies are actually contacting us. We have stopped the traffic. We're part of the free trade chocolate movement that started some of these conversations in Nestle and these big chocolate companies. So these postcards, while you might think, what's a postcard going to do? It's like Steve's snowflake story. They really do make a difference. When we send these to the CEO of global companies, they stand up and take notice and have conversations with us. So tell your friends, start conversations in your local communities, check out the Stop the Traffic resources. We've also got one where you can pick up one of these, pop it in your pocket. It flips out and tells you the indicators. What are the signs that you should be looking for in your communities, in residential houses, if you're going into residential services or properties as part of your job? How can you be spotting the signs of people who might have been trafficked in your communities?
Thank you very much. Marcus?
An interesting study just before the last general election, that increasingly people trust as a news source, most of all, stories and articles that are posted by their friends on social media. Perhaps one thing which you can do is to look out for stories about modern slavery, about trafficking. Look out for good news stories about how to fight it. Look out for horror stories about what's happened, and actually increase the sum of knowledge about this issue. Because as I said earlier, if we can make drink driving unacceptable, we should be able to make using slave-produced goods totally socially unacceptable.
Thank you. Steve?
Yeah, well, I wanted to address the young 27-year-old man at the back who's thinking about working in Asia. I think it's a great idea. I read in a magazine earlier today that it's 2% of the people in any population that make 98% of the difference. I don't know who did that statistic. I'm not sure whether it's actually true, But it is true, if you see what I mean. It might be 3% of people who make 97% of the difference, but we know that it's the kind of person who will not sit in front of a television set, who in the end will get, I'm not picking on TV, I used to work in it, but will get off their bottom, will reach to a place where to sing songs and to recite prayers is not enough. We become the song, we become the prayer. The fact that you're not qualified, you're not trained, I don't think makes the slightest bit of difference at all. I think that what you should do is you should research the kind of organisations, which organisations are working down on the ground in the Asian country that you, or Asian countries that you'd like to go, and raise some money, go and serve there with them as an intern for a year. You're young, free and single, I take it. So you can rush out there. Oh no, you're not young or free. Well, you're young, but you're not free and you're not single. So so you're gonna have to raise, yeah, you're gonna have to negotiate first and both head off, right? So why can't you go, Oasis, the charity I first founded, works in India. I'm not, this isn't an advert for you to come and work with us at all. But a young, bright couple who wanna give themselves and work in community, oh, any charity's gonna bite your arm off for that. So go learn, work, and then you'll find that you are developing into somebody who does know. And then you'll know what bit of study to do and how the study and reflection fits in with the practice. You know, we grow in life. I am an educationist now, never used to be. I'm responsible for running 47 schools around this country. All education is, first of all, this is called closed learning cycle. You have to begin with an activity, then you need to reflect on that activity, then you form a new theory based on your reflection, then you act in a more intelligent way, and then you reflect on that, and then you theorize again, etc., etc. But the way in is to do something, so go do it.
Thank you. And finally, Andrew.
I've got four, and I've got the mic, till Lucy stares at me.
We've got the switch.
Yes. Touché. I can talk very loudly if I need to. Okay, here's four quick things you can do. First one, and it might be a curveball. I would encourage you to write to the Home Secretary and Karen Bradley and thank them for the Modern Slavery Act. Why? Because politicians never get thanks, they just get whinge. And actually, what motivates people? Because I can tell you, and I know both of them, they have got their teeth into this issue and they're not going to let go. And receiving letters, not emails, not via, you know, whatever, they work for you, write them a letter, post it. I know it's a hassle, but, you know, just embrace the 20th century for once. Just send them letters, say thank you for what you've done, please keep going. Will deliver huge dividends. Then write to your MP and say, will the government as a whole, in asking private businesses to start reporting, will government start now taking these issues to heart as well? Because actually the government's the biggest purchaser in the land. And then choose what you do with your resources wisely. We only have three resources in life: time, energy, and money. Use them wisely. The trouble is now, you can't walk out of here and say you don't know about the issues. The question is what you're going to do as a result of knowing about the issues. And then fourthly, realize what we're talking about is a really complicated issue. There aren't any simple solutions, and they take time. And so my encouragement is just to be persistent and keep going and keep wrestling with this issue, because it will change and morph. It has changed and morphed out of all recognition in the last 5 years, and it will change again in the next 5 years, and we just have to keep going at it.
Please do stay for a drink over here, and there is lots of information about all that you've heard about this evening. Could I, on your behalf, thank Amy, Marcus, Steve, and Andrew for a really excellent evening. Thank you very much indeed.